Hey everybody, tonight we're going to talk about something related to what we've been discussing in floods and rains and what happens to gold. We're going to talk specifically about how changes in the stream flow affect placer gold deposits. So the objective here is just simply a kind of a chalk talk. I mean, we'd spend some time on the blackboard going over how the things we've been looking at this last weekend, because you know this has been flood week, like shark week. And so the idea here is let's look at what happens as these floods go up and as they go down to the stream bed. I have some pictures in there that I'm showing. For example, this one that I'm showing on the side over here is basically cobbles and a sample hole that I have where I'm going down to bedrock through a bunch of layers that were laid down by various flood conditions. Different layers had different amounts of gold. And so it's important to understand a little bit more about how that happens and what that has to do with you. Because when you're prospecting for gold, you want to be able to find those layers, understand how they affect the gold and its depositing, and where to go next. After all, this was just a sample hole. We're looking for the pay streak in those conditions. So let's take a look. Back to the front cover page here. You can see the layers in this one structure. There's sort of this concreted segment down below where it's sandy clays, and then there's these rounded cobbles that are sort of hovering up above in space. And you say, how could that be? How can that happen, PJ? And the answer is floods. Floods have certain properties, and as they take place, those properties come into play and cause layers to be laid down. There's a little bit of understanding of the hydrodynamics and the slurry itself, the suspension of materials in a gravitational field. It's kind of floating, if you will, but they're really not. They're bouncing around on top of each other. And the idea is, if you understand a little bit more about how that works, you can understand kind of what causes this kind of a sill and where the gold would be in this situation. I'll give you a hint. I'm pointing to it in the center of the screen. But the idea is, how did it get there? And that I'll talk about in a second here. So let's go over to the blackboard for a second and look at stream flow and placer gold. So when we start off with a flood and we have some bed erosion, you know, pretty much we have a stream that looks like this and then kind of has a V-shaped notch in the bottom and then another set of banks on the other side. And so the idea is, at some point, the water is flowing along under normal conditions, and you know there's no flooding or there's no fast flow or rapid erosion. And so under those conditions, this bottom might be covered with some material, and in there might be suspended rocks and cobbles and various other smiley faces, and there might also be some other interesting stuff that would give you some idea of where we're going next, and that is little pieces of gold here that might be buried at the bottom of this thing. There also might be some out here, you just don't know. But the objective is we're looking into the stream bed. This is bedrock over here, so really we're not gonna see anything over here. Where we're gonna see it mostly is in this bottom, but there's a reason it got where it is, and there might be some other reasons that it might be someplace else. I'll go into that in a second. So normal conditions, stream's full, might not be completely full. In summertime, it might only be filled to this point, and it might just be a little tiny riffle of water in here flowing through, and it might meander back and forth in the stream bed. You just don't know. But the idea is, that's how it looks when it's under normal conditions. What we're gonna do now is take a look at what happens to this same stream bed when we start heading into flood flow. So under full load, full flood, there's not going to be much down here at the bottom at all. The water levels are going to be at the top, and if not flowing over the edges. And so under these conditions, there's a huge velocity gradient across this thing going downstream as fast as it can. So all those rocks and cobbles, the only ones that are going to be left are the biggest ones. Stuff that might not be moved. Everything else, silt, small gravels, etc., speeding downstream, finding the nearest boulder to hide behind, or some bushes or things like that that are tied to the edge of the creek and they're going to hide there. But at this point, we scrubbed it to the bottom. And so under these conditions, the only thing left at the very, very bottom is going to be heavy, heavy gravels and some large chunky gold, if there is any. And so the idea is that, and they'll be buried right down to bedrock. So they're going to sit mainly on this surface here. So the idea is we want to understand what happens next. Well, as this flood starts to abate or slow down, then the conditions get interesting, because what's really happening here, if you look closely, is, and I'm going to paint these in a kind of blue or green, but what we have here are the rest of the material, which is zooming downstream as a slurry of material, and only the biggest cobbles are going to be caught on the bottom, the big boulders, and maybe things that are trapped underneath those. But the rest of this stuff is going to be shooting downstream, and any mud and silt, it's going downstream as fast as it can. And with that goes any flower gold, any lighter golds. So they're hidden in here as a bunch of little particles that are just kind of scooting along with those, you know, flakes of gold and nuggets and rocks. Not nuggets, the rocks and small particles of gold. The stuff that are nuggets are heavy and dense enough that they don't get carried along with this thing unless it's a full-blown flash flood. And under those conditions, those things can move. But otherwise, they sit there and continue to concentrate over the years. The rest of this stuff is going downstream and looking for a place where the water pools and slows down. As it pools and slows down, boom, drops out. So now let's go to the next condition. So now we go to the next condition when our stream starts to slow down. And under these conditions, the water is receding. Okay, it's not at full, it's not flowing over the sides. And those particles and things are starting to, you know, mix in with those cobbles and boulders we saw on the bottom and fill in with silt and sands. So there's lots of little particles packing in here now. It's still been vibrating as it's going down. So what happens is this stuff has a chance to accrete, they call it, which simply means to pile up. And this is the stuff in the summer season, or if it's a stream that's been suspended, it's essentially going to lead you to what is called overburden. It's the material that has no gold, or not much. The only gold it might have would be light flower gold. And so when we look at this stuff, as it accretes, we're going to see the gold is still down here, hidden under these rocks and cobbles, the big boulders. And then there might be some more picker kind of gold right in here, but nothing big in way of you know, nuggets. They're down on the bottom on bedrock. Up here is still some particles that are floating around with our friend the mud and silt, okay, that green stuff. And so it's still floating out here, kind of working its way down to the bottom, but it's still flowing fast enough that it hasn't really settled out yet. So these flower gold particles are going to continue to go on downstream with the rest of that flow until they find a pool or something stagnant that's slow enough that they can begin to drift to the bottom. Does that make sense? So that's an important aspect of how the flood transitions from a flood to still water or just a brook or a stream. And so now we go into the mode where we're looking at this intermediate flow. We continue to go down looking at the flow as it hits its normal flow, as we were talking about, where we are at summer level, and that looks something like this. And our water flow is way down here, and our rocks and cobbles are still hanging in the bottom, but we might even have some material that has built up on the sides here. That's mud, silt, sand, and small gravels. And buried in it might be a little bit of picker gold, coarse gold, that has found its way into this material and deposited again toward bedrock. And our big nuggets are still going to be buried down here underneath the rocks, cobbles, and boulders that are in the center. Why would they be in the center? Well, that's because that's where the torrent came through and ripped out everything else. And so the only thing that could stick were those big cobbles. Big hint. See big cobbles? Think big storm must have moved through here at some time. And therefore, below those big cobbles can be some opportunity, especially as it heads toward bedrock or a false bedrock made out of clay. So any of these conditions can be interesting to you. Now, under these conditions, one of the things you want to watch for is sometimes these things are just dry. There's no water at all. But a lot of times the water is just simply down in here, you know, flowing along in a little meandering stream that's a brook running down the center line of this thing. Or not even center line, kind of like a drunken, you know, sailor. It's all over the place. It doesn't represent, key point, it doesn't represent the real flood flow that went through this valley. That's why you need to know those high water lines we talked about last night or night before last. But the idea is, hey, if you've got an idea of where this high water is and you know where it's settling the material out here by looking for these bigger cobbles, you have some idea of what's going on. But notice it transitioned into this dropping these finer things. Oh, and by the way, way over in here in some corner would be a final pool. I didn't show it here, but would be a pool where it dropped out all the flower gold. And typically with that, you'll find lots of sands that are heavy in black sands. So that's it for tonight. Prospector Jess over and out. Just thought I'd touch you up and tell you where stream flow and placer gold connect. So good prospecting. Hey, and I cover some of this material in 2020 prospecting as well. It's part of that same training. So if you want to look for that, just go ahead. So I'll catch you later. Next transmission coming from huntingforgold.com and Prospector Jess. Over and out.